Okay.
We're in the back row.
You can hear me? Okay, then we're good. First of all, I just want to say thank you for being here today. Your presence means more than you probably even realize. This is a time to remember Dale, and your presence with family is just going to be phenomenal. And this breeze, thank you, God. We do appreciate that. I'm Debbie Dilkin. I'm the care pastor at First Christian Church, where Diane has been attending church, as well as she has been a long-time member of our Quilty group, Read What You Sow. And I know that we have quite a few of our members here today. There's actually three goals that we have this afternoon. The first one is going to be to remember and to honor Dale. And then the second one is going to be to comfort the family. And the third goal is going to be to glorify God. Now, I have to be honest, I only knew Dale through Diane. So I'm going to be getting to know him in a deeper sense, probably up to many of you. So as we start this time together, please join me in prayer. Gracious Father, I just want to thank you for being here with us today. Father, let your presence be felt by all. You know every emotion that is happening in every heart right now. And Father, there's grief, and there's joy of being reconnected as a family. There's sadness, and yet there's joy. Father, we ask that you take each and every moment, each and everything that is shared, and allow it to be a sweet fragrance unto you, and of comfort to each person here. Not just those that are here, but those that will be hearing of this time together through the video. Father, we thank you for Dale. We thank you for his life. We thank you for his influence. So I pray that as we share and as we discuss, that will truly be felt by all. We give this time to you. In your son's precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Got these 5 men in the front row. I feel somewhat intimidated. Not really. Dale Everett Lewis was born October 2nd, 1946, in Sioux City, Iowa, to Ben and Dorothy Matthews Lewis. He was number 11 of 15 children. Dale, along with several of his younger siblings, were placed in the foster care system. And if I recall correctly, he had several foster parents. But one primary?
Dale only had one set.
Okay, I got that.
He was
Virgil.
Okay.
Yeah, I said I was going to get something not quite like. Right. Dale lived all over Iowa during his lifetime. I didn't realize there were this many cities in Iowa. Sioux City, Davenport, Grand Junction, Ames, Des Moines, Cedar Rapids, and then other places that he got to call home were San Antonio, Tucson, and then as well. At one time, he was a postal worker, but primarily he was in the insurance business. He retired about 5 years ago, with the last part of his working career being in the reverse mortgage area. I asked Diane how they met, and she said something along the line of cruising in through Iowa. But the two significant parts of how they met, or their first date, were the fact that wore a suit, and if I recall correctly, you told me there are no more suits. No more suits, but the first date he was in a suit, and the family dog, the collie, liked him. The dog had not liked any of her other male friends, so that was significant. The dog liked him, he was in. Some of the interesting points and facts regarding Dale's life included: he was a quiet person, he was a good mentor, he was considered the activity planner for family visits, he was very often the kid himself, and I do hope that somebody in the family will share the story about him getting stuck in a tube at the science center. He didn't wear shorts, that was what I was told, until just recently. He wore black tennis shoes and socks, black socks. He loved country music and Elvis. He loved his cowboy. cowboy boots, which are on display over here. He was a duck hunter. And he was a cat person, which is why, which is perfectly fine with me, and is why I'm in my cat outfit. And I have cats this same color as a couple of their cats. Yeah. And he had a duck collection, rubber duckies. If you have not seen a rubber ducky collection, you're missing something. I was quite amazed at the collection that I had. I asked, he was also extremely family-oriented, and we'll get into that a little bit more. And it was very patriotic. And I asked Diane, was there something significant about his patriotism? When did that really hit him? Or was it something he grew up with? And she said that it was 9/11, that day of 9/11. Part of the reason, one of the significant parts of that, is that his son Tony was in New York City at the time. And Tony's friend Mike, who is also here today, they were both in New York City at the time of 9/11. Now, I can't imagine what that must have felt like as a family, trying to find that day. Dale is survived by his wife Diane, their son Tony, daughter-in-law Kimberly, daughter Wendy, and husband Kevin, grandchildren Amy, Rachel, Aaron, and Sean, his siblings Bonnie, Elroy, Ronald, Flora, Michael, and Randall, and the gents are here in front.
Jimmy.
You're there. You're James, I'm sorry. You are there. And lots of nieces and nephews. He is preceded in death by his siblings Earl, Joyce, Ralph, Robert, George, Jerry, and Pearl. There is a lot more to Dale's life and his family life than what I can share. I truly hope that those of you who knew him personally were given the opportunity to share a little bit about his life and his personal life. Because I've given you some facts of what you knew him on a personal level. In talking to Diane, Dale's faith walk could be described as a quiet one that was lived out. As a child, he went to church with his grandmother, as well as during the time that he was with his foster parents. And to most of us that grew up in that time period, as Dale and some of you guys did, the 23rd Psalm was a familiar passage. What I'd like to share now is what's called the new 23rd Psalm. Because the Lord is my shepherd, I have everything I need. He leads me beside the quiet stream, giving life to me, and he helps me do what honors him the most. Even when walking through the dark shadow of the valley of death, I will not be afraid, for he is close beside me, guarding, guiding all the way. He spreads a feast before me in the presence of my enemies. He welcomes me as his special guest. His goodness and unfailing kindness will be with me all the days of my life, and afterward, I will live with him forever in his home. The key verse in that psalm that I believe scales life, was the line. He keeps on giving life to me and helps me do what honors him, meaning the Lord, the most. And talking with Diane and with Carla, I believe that for Dale, it was his family in many, many ways. I am sure that many of you read the story or heard the story of how the family was separated, the siblings were separated, and the search to find the younger members of the family that took place, and how Dale really helped spearhead that, and that they were joined back together. And I just think it is such a thrill and honor to have you gents here today. I come from a large blended family of 15, but to have natural siblings of 15 and five of you, I think speaks to the world of your family and your devotion and your commitment to being here. As I said, there's a whole lot more that can be said about the family, and I keep asking, and I hope that you will share some of that, regardless of how long it is out there. But as I think about the family, I want you to keep this in mind. When I talked to Diane last week, her words were, "I'm still in shock." I am sure, Diane, over this last week, there's some pieces of reality that have come into place. In the Bible, in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, these words of the Apostle Paul are recorded. Praise be to God. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles. God himself promises to be our comforter, yet he allows us the privilege of being comforters to one another, that we have the privilege of coming alongside one another. Our society is an instant society. If something doesn't happen instantaneously, like being connected to Bluetooth, then we get frustrated. And that has flown over also into the grieving process. That's not reality. To Dale's family, I want to encourage you to love and support and care for one another, not just in this immediate time period, but in the days, months, and years ahead. Laugh and tell those stories. And anybody that has a rubber ducky collection has to have a lot of stories to be told. You need to cry, and you need to hug each other, and you need to stay connected. To those of us that are here as friends, I would say, please continue to be there. Talk about Dale, and allow the family to talk about Dale. There's something in our society that says we can't talk about someone that has passed because it might make the family member cry. Well, they may need that, or they may just need to sit quietly. So as friends, I ask you to stay alongside this family and be their support. In wrapping up my portion of this, I want to go back to the 23rd Psalm. The very last line says, "And afterwards I will live with him forever in his home." We are eternal beings. Dale is on the other side of that eternity. And in thinking about his love for Elvis, a song came to my mind. And the song is entitled, "One Pair of Hands." It was written by a gentleman named Carol Robertson. And Elvis made a recording of it, but it's considered a lost recording. It was never made its way, it was never released by Elvis. But I believe the message in that song is what Dale would say to us today, with him on the other side of the journey. Now the prayer is, can I get this to work?
flower, every tree. One perfect on the valleys, the ocean, the rivers, and the sand.